Hi, good morning, Eric Bollert.
Good morning.
I just, even before I read your pieces, I just read your tweets. I'm like, yes, yes, right there, yes.
Oh, no.
No, you are absolutely right. You said, astonished by a president who's deliberately made every wrong move when faced with a crippling pandemic, and one who refuses to change course as the carnage mounts, media players continue to express shock over Trump's behavior. Okay. We've had Joe and Mika on this show. I like them personally, but Mika Brzezinski actually said, we never thought we'd be seeing this. Nobody did. It's not just us. It's Hillary Clinton who went to parties with him. You said that is the definition of gaslighting, the purposeful erasing of history. In this case, it's Brzezinski trying to erase the central role she played in that history. Clinton didn't know about Trump's dangerous ways or warn us 4 years ago. It is categorically false. She called him dangerously incoherent. The reason Brzezinski may have missed Clinton's warnings was because she was relentlessly bashing Clinton during the campaign while propping up Trump's run. We all remember it. Breathlessly, like a celebrity, taking phone calls on the air from him. You know, he didn't even have to come in studio. It was just, I know. Particularly now, Eric, with everything that's going on. And you can play 1,000 clips of Hillary warning us about absolutely everything that has happened, right?
Yeah. And Mika's comments on Friday were, things are so bad, right? This pandemic is completely out of control. Trump is calling to zero out funding for the CDC testing. I mean, he is doubling and tripling down on this maniacal plot against America that he's waging. So, but for 4 years, we're still seeing, the pundits in the chattering class acting surprised by what Trump does. To me, it's mind-boggling. He has one of these incoherent Rose Garden events, and CNN reporters admit. Talk about how shocked he is that he would turn a Rose Garden event into an anti-Biden campaign event. He's disgraced the White House. It's July of 2020. So Mika was talking about that. Oh, nobody possibly could have known. Nobody knew he was a psychopath. She didn't use that word. I am. But then she goes one step farther and she said, nobody warned us. And she said that includes Hillary. Hillary went to parties with Donald Trump, back in the 90s. So she's putting Hillary, who ran against Trump and literally did nothing from the spring of 2016 to Election Day, but warn us about Trump and what a catastrophe it would be. And a lot of people like Mika and others kind of rolled their eyes. Oh, that's just rhetoric. She's being, overly dramatic. He's a reality TV show. He's a guy from The Apprentice.
Right.
This will be kind of fun. We'll mix it up. We'll have a businessman in the White House. What is she? Yeah. She's such gold. Why can't she lighten up?
Yeah. It hit the zenith when Chuck Todd actually said, well, at times it just seemed Hillary seemed overprepared in this debate. I think that hurt her. I mean, it's just everything we're living through now. You have these flashbacks,
yes.
Eric, and I was going to say, you were talking about specifically Joe and Mika, but
first
of all, if you've read Mary Trump's book or watched any of her interviews, I mean, they all knew this. Even his own sister said he's a clown. He's never accomplished anything on his own. He's except 5 bankruptcies. Anyone in the Trump family or in New York knew he was a joke. Joe and Mika knew he was a joke, but you're right. It was all about ratings and, this is fun and Hillary's going to crush him anyway. And, this will be a fun. And this is where we are now. I mean, the Trump family was astonished that anyone in America, because of the Apprentice, had any other view of him than that he's a ridiculous clown, failed businessman, right?
Yeah. I mean, people in the New York area, people in Atlantic City, people in New Jersey knew he had stiffed countless people out of hundreds of millions of dollars, cabinet makers, contractors, plumbers, electricians, they all looked at each other like, how is this guy ever going to run for president? He owes us millions of dollars. He's a cheat. He's a con man. But it was a combination. This will be fun. Hillary's going to win. We want to diminish her win. We don't like her. We want her to limp across the finish line. We are going to batter her like she has never been battered in public before. And we go to Joe and Mika. And, I kind of forgot when I was doing my column, I kind of thought they jumped on the bandwagon during the primary, the Republican primary. They had him on. He was good for ratings. It was during the general election. I mean, they were relentless in terms of their attacks on Hillary. They were meeting with the Trump crew during the transition after he won.
Yeah.
So this was not like, oh, Trump's the new thing. you know, we're gonna be buddy buddy with him for a few months in 2015, 2016. And I mentioned in my piece, I mean, I could have written 10 pages about what they did, but in the October of 96, New York Times reported that Trump lost $900 million in 1995. That's why he didn't pay taxes. Mika runs on the air. She talks about Trump's brilliant response to the revelation, and she tells Hillary to get, quote, get off your high horse and stop talking about his taxes, because you gave paid speeches, and that's the same thing as not paying taxes.
Yeah, that's exactly
we forget.
Same. Yeah.
And okay, you make a mistake. Admit it today. I don't, you know, obviously they're part of the resistance now, and that they're very critical of Trump. They call out his corruption, his criminality. That's great. You got to admit what you did. And you can't gaslight us about Hillary didn't warn us. We all knew what Hillary was saying, but that pundit class in the Beltway didn't want to listen to her because they didn't like her and they thought it was going to, you know, yeah. They wanted to have some fun with it.
I mean, and talk about
we are with almost 140,000 people dead.
Yeah, and that every road leads to Putin. As Hillary said, Hillary called everything, and every story now leads back to Russia, including the Russian bounty, and I'm sure what's in his taxes. Which, you know, there's still an outside chance we will see, you know, from the state of New York before the election. But who knows? I mean, it is kind of actually eerie when you watch clips of Hillary, you know, whether it's from the debates or whatever. You're like, oh, my God.
It is. It absolutely is. Yeah. And because even I, when I was watching it, I was like, OK, this is important. This is important information. I get what she's saying. But even I don't think I really understood exactly what she meant, but she's been the Secretary of State, she's been a senator, she knows national security. She saw exactly where all of this was going. If you have a foreign interference that you are actively courting and you refuse to condemn, that's not a one-off. That is his entire worldview, and he's going to continue that if he's elected president. And there's an entire Twitter feed. Hillary was right about everything. It's true.
Well, I mean, and cut to now, Joe Biden revealed Friday that he's now getting intelligence briefings and says that both China and Russia are trying to undermine the legitimacy of the 2020 election, which we know. And cut to, as you talk about the media coverage, Biden holds a lead of 28 points among registered voters under 40, larger than the 16-point margin by which Hillary won that group in 2016. And you can still see, like you say, in places, the coverage where they're still trying to make it a race, despite the fact that we are... I mean, this tweet summed it up for me this morning. Stuart Stevens, Republican strategist, he said, Americans are too dangerous for the Bahamas. We can't go to Canada. We can't go to Mexico. We can't go to England. We can't go to any Western democracy. 3.5 years with Trump as president, and America is a pariah country. Well done, Republicans. I mean, and yet we're still trying to cover this in some quarters like this is a, you know, regular race.
And a country
this
like...
This is what drives me crazy, and I tweeted about it over the weekend, right? So the New York Times on Saturday has this big, admirable piece, 5 reporters. This is what Trump did wrong. Big TikTok story on the pandemic, focusing on all the wrong decisions in April. And I tweeted, I said, I'm frankly tired of reading these stories. I've read at least 7 of these in-depth pieces, and they all stop at the exact same point, and they all refuse to ask why. Yeah. Why did he do this? Why did he give a stand down order? Why did he welcome this invasion? Why won't he change course? Oh, well, he was worried about re-election. Oh, he wanted to dump it on the states. That doesn't explain why you refused to change course over 4 months and 140,000 people dead. So, you know, and it's just this timidity, and it's the refusal to ask the dark questions about what does America do when the president is waging war on this country? We know he screwed up. He's done it every possible way.
Right.
We could list 10 pages of everything he's done wrong since March on the pandemic. You have to ask why. Why is this happening? It's a pathology, and we're not going to obviously, I think they're trying to run out the clock. They think he's going to lose. They don't ever want to have to deal with these difficult questions. But my God, in terms of
That has that flashback feeling, doesn't it? This is where we were, like, oh, Hillary's going to win. This won't matter. And
absolutely.
I mean, I think this time we're terrified because this is like we've seen this movie before. We've seen this horror movie. And, you know, like you talk about him saying just a couple days ago that he won Michigan's Man of the Year. And you say pathological liars lie about everything.
Everything.
He lies about absolutely everything. I mean, it just gets okay.
And that's another thing I have to say. You know, something came up last week. I can't remember what it was. And some of this was from the Chris Wallace interview on the weekends. People are amazed that he caught Trump in a lie. But I was tweeting about something last week that was like, we are so past the point of gotcha. Like, why are we even wasting our time doing these gotcha moments? Oh, Trump flip-flopped or Trump lied about this. It's irrelevant at this point. It's completely irrelevant because if he's talking, he's lying. And well, again, right. the press needs to take the next step. Why is he doing this? Because he's a pathological liar, but they refuse to have
No, it's like shocking headline. Chris Wallace does basic journalism that all journalists should have been doing for the last 4 years. Like, okay.
It was refreshing only because it has been absent up until now.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yes. Exactly.
Yeah. Finally, Eric, you wrote, I mean, this is a perfect example, USA Today publishing this ridiculous Peter Navarro, who is a complete crank conspiracy theorist. So they published his... You know, again, here we are with opinion. Here's my opinion, and here's the top epidemiologist in the world, Dr. Fauci's opinion. So he writes this piece bashing Dr. Fauci. You say Peter Navarro, who has no medical background, his piece was clearly part of a larger orchestrated campaign by the White House to smear Dr. Fauci, but you're talking about USA Today's decision to just run that, right?
Yeah. Well, they clearly wanted to have a both sides debate. USA Today ran a smart editorial saying, do not hide Fauci, do not attack Fauci. But the press is so wed to this idea, particularly other than Trump, we have to give them a platform. They invited his trade advisor, who doesn't know anything about medicine or disease or anything, who writes a column, here's everything that Fauci's been wrong about. A, the White House immediately distanced itself. Who knows if that was serious or not? I mean, you can't trust anything they said. I wrote a column. I said, this is insane. You editors have to understand. Giving a platform to a bunch of liars to attack America's top doctor during a national health crisis is a really bad idea.
Well, that's what you say. It's life or death. It's a public, it is dangerous to the public. It's not just a bad, stupid, both sides do it decision. It is, you're putting that out as if that has equal weight medically as anything Dr. Fauci would say, right?
And then the next day, USA Today apologized. They said, the column wasn't up to their fact-checking standards. But I mean, as I pointed out, the problems with the piece were so blindingly obvious. No one in their right mind ever should have done that, just like the New York Times never should have run an op-ed from Senator Cotton saying, hey, let's do martial law. I mean, you have to use your head, and you have to get away from this. We have to give Republicans a platform. In a normal world, yes, give Republicans and Democrats a platform they can debate. When you have a Republican Party that has become a death party, pathological liars, are wed to this idea that we're going to march 57 million kids into schools and who cares what happens to them. No, they don't deserve a platform.
Is it wrong to hope that I'm just propose that maybe we could put Mika and USA Today on a polar ice floe until this election is over, until the danger is passed, and then we'll welcome them back. Okay.
Hopefully they'll learn.
Yeah.
All right. Love you, Eric. Thank you.
Thanks, Eric.
Press Run.
Pressrun.media. And please subscribe. He would appreciate
it. All right. Love you, Eric.
Have a great week.